you know where exactly I'm going to go, right? There is no question where I'm going to go. You know exactly where I'm going to go. Oh yeah, before any of you freak out after that, there are other things that I just copied, but you know, for example, I don't have the audio lectures on page 11, I don't require your textbook here. Page 12 is just information for further studies. If you decide you want to borrow something from the library and you finally find it, that would be a good place for you to start. There will be quizzes, but the quizzes will be diagnostic. You know, the only thing that will really matter is your midterms and finals. Okay, so when I feel that there is a lack of understanding of how I taught or I was not able to communicate correctly with you, I will do a quiz. I'll say, here's 15 questions, answer it, you have 10 minutes. You know, of course, my assumption is that you know the answers because I taught, right? I taught it, so I think you know the answer. And then I take those back. I don't bring them. I may give you or not give you feedback. Basically, the feedback will be the next lecture. Okay? Remember that when we come together, we're not coming together to show, like I told the students the other night, it's not that I am less or smart. It's that I am a teacher. For some reason, God allows me to function as a teacher, not you guys. Okay? In this setting only, right? In this setting, I'm not talking about anything else, your children, your work, your school. It has nothing to do with that. Just this little corner here, this little 1 hour moment. And so, I will endeavor to try to teach as best I can. Right? I will teach. That's my job. I will do that. The objective, of course, is to make you more aware and quote unquote more trained, more learned after every time that we sit down. Alright?
Just one question?
Yeah.
And here it says the textbooks, the recommended ones aren't the ones on the list though, right?
No. Alright, nothing to do with that. That's why I said don't bother with that, right? What you're going to pay attention to is lessons 1 to 12. That way you have preparation. And then you use the textbooks that you have. If you were able to get your hands on the textbooks, or you have a textbook of your own in Hermeneutics, you find, or you go on the internet. Those of you that want your master's, that's how you're going to do it later on if you have to research. So you use textbooks and postings, and you use that in credit for credits to do it, etc. Okay, define Hermeneutics. Those of you that were here before, what's Hermeneutics?
Correct interpretation of the Bible.
Right. Hermeneutics is not just biblical, of course. Hermeneutics can be applied secularly, but biblical hermeneutics, of course, is a different standard because now you are messing with the Word of God. If, for example, I'm a stockbroker and I read an analysis and I say, well, you know, I believe that stock's going to go up. Then I go to Anna and I say to Anna, give me $5,000 and buy some shares. So Anna says, okay, no problem. You know, here's $5,000, I trust you, I think we will make money together. And by the way, of course, if you ever meet anybody that tells you that, I guarantee you will make at least 8%. Because there are certain things out there that you can say, I guarantee your capital. Yes, there are. Those of you that are in finances, you can see that. But you cannot go and say, I'm going to make sure you make at least 7%. You know? Meaning guarantee your capital, meaning you not gain or lose. That just means if I held your money and put it under the ground, I guarantee that's going to be the same, right? Your $5,000 is still going to be $5,000 after I pull it out of the ground. But you buy stocks, the market tanks 20%. So in 3 days, her money was $5,000, now only $4,000. The secular hermeneutics I applied was to see how markets go, how companies go. Okay, I was wrong. The consequence, of course, would be two things. If I did my job legally, nothing but that, she would probably not want to invest in me anymore, unless the market recovers. Right, you're still catching me? Because she lost money, of course, there's a bad will, but you cannot sue me. You know, because as we know, when you buy stocks, there's always the risk element. And because I told her I guarantee, which I will not say. Okay? So I will not tell you that I guarantee that you will make so and so. So having said that, okay, having said that, biblical hermeneutics is a whole different thing. It cannot be like speculation and stuff. Oh, let me buy gold. Oh, I bought gold at 1800, now it's worth 1500. Oh, lost 300. Well, you know what? Money, 300 bucks. Sure. But when you interpret scripture, when you define, okay, the meanings of what you are reading in scripture, you better know what you're talking about, because the cost, the stakes that we are playing with is not money. What are we playing with?
So,
people go to hell and heaven on things that you say. Wow, never thought about that. Who of you still want to be pastors? People go to hell and heaven based on the things that you say, how you carry yourselves. And so when it comes to hermeneutics, we have to be very, very, very careful. Okay? Explain the need for special hermeneutics for specific portions of scripture. What kind of scripture are you familiar with? I mean, you know, there's all these books. There's the Bible. What is in the Bible? What kind of things? What kind of forms of literature are in the Bible?
There are history.
Okay, history. So certain writings are historical. Alright, I agree. Jesus is a historical figure. I agree. Alright, we have no problem with that. Alright, what else?
Parables.
Parables, okay, what are those things? What kind of writing is that? Parables.
Psalms.
Psalms. You have parables.
Yeah.
You have parables and proverbs. What kind of writings are those?
Are they story?
Yes, but what kind of story? They're wisdom writings. Right? Not Psalms. The Psalms is what? Music, right?
Praise.
Right, there's Psalms, so there's place. Poetry and place. Okay.
So parabolic are the same, right?
Parables is wisdom writing, in my opinion. Right? You don't have to abide by what I'm telling you. I'm just saying, we're trying to categorize what you see, right? So there's historical things, right? There's parables and proverbs, which are, that's not the main classification, but it's called wisdom writing, right? Let me go over the camera. Take this off. These are some of the things that you will see in your scripture. See, now you're lecturing. I'm not lecturing. You're telling me what's there. Number one, history. Right? Number two, wisdom. What else? Well, we already said poetry, right? And poetry is what?
Psalms.
Okay, those are some of those examples. Okay, what else?
Prophecy.
Okay, prophecy. Mm-hmm. Give me an example.
Revelation.
Revelation, yes. What else? Daniel?
Isaiah.
Mm-hmm. Prophecy, because there's a? How will you know that it's a prophecy? It's a prophecy, I think. How will you know?
It's going to happen in the future.
Oh, yeah. What's the dead giveaway?
It hasn't happened yet.
Okay. What's the dead giveaway? It's written by a? Major or minor?
Prophet.
There you go. Right? It's that simple. Major is. So,
what about
a
chapel?
Right? Who else? Who are the other prophets that you know? Amos.
Isaiah.
Okay.
Yeah, Ezekiel.
Alright. And then, of course, there's Revelation. Right? So, that's more or less the general categories. There's four general categories. Okay? Now, every category that you have, okay, every category that you have, you need to interpret in a different way. Okay? Meaning, you come in and you prepare yourself. When you read, you prepare yourself with the objective in your head. You're saying, oh, okay, this is a poetical thing. Okay? This is a prophetic thing. For example, Revelations. And behold, I see a pale horse. There's such a thing as a pale horse. Have you ever seen a pale horse?
Once.
Pale horse? Does, horse ever become pale? Any of you know what horses are?
I've never seen a pale horse.
There's no pale horse. There's a white horse. There's a black horse. There's a pinto. There's a mustang. You know? Then you have the Arabian breeds, you know, that they call the thoroughbreds. They're black, they're brown, they're chestnut. But you've never seen a pale horse, right? Because in Revelation, if I understand, the pale horse is not pale. It's like the color of vomit.
Like green.
Yeah. Okay? To differentiate from the white horse. There's a white horse. That's a white horse. Easy. There's a pale horse. But the pale horse is not pale white. The pale horse is green. And that's another story. But see, now you need to read in such a way that you prepare your mind when you read prophecy that, you know, it helps you to understand. You cannot read it like the Sermon on the Mount. Right? For example, one of the most intricate poetries that we've seen is the book that tells us about sex, but that song of?
Song of Solomon.
That's all poetry.
Yeah.
That's all poetry.
Graphic.
Yeah, you want graphic? There you go. Oh, your knees. Oh, your breasts. You know? When I was young, I don't read that because, you know, now I'm 14 years old, it's not appropriate to read. I tried, but you know what? It just messed you up. Back in the day when you were 14, 15, 16, your hormones were so... And I wasn't prepared. Nobody told me that that was for that. It's a poetic thing, you know? And I'm reading it and I'm going, yeah, it's here. You don't even have to buy me back in the day, we have no internet. You don't even have to look at Playboy, here it is. Okay. But, you know, you have to prepare yourself. You have to have a certain attitude, a certain approach to that form. Okay, and then the wisdom portions. You know, there are certain writings that you read and then you expound on. And the wisdom portions, really what you really need to do is apply it to your life before you can even preach it. So this is how we read these things and this is how we understand. Okay? Now, let's cite several limitations of hermeneutics in the study of the Bible. What's the limitations you think? Even as we have already become organized and we have the theological ideas to what the Bible is all about. You know what the Bible is all about, right? Like some of this, just before the beginning of the class, somebody was asking me, how do people who were in the Old Testament get saved? You know? What's the answer? There's no Messiah. What's the answer?
Through the sacrifice.
Through the sacrifice. Or through the shedding of the blood, or through the obedience to that prescription. That was the prescribed way to be saved. Before Jesus came, people shed the blood. That's why we don't shed the blood right now. Had Jesus not come, we'd still be shedding blood. We won't be mad at our chickens. We won't kill the chickens. Yeah? There'll be blood on our altars. Because that's how salvation was accomplished back then. It was by following the word of God. That was what was commanded, so that's what you do. It's simple. Yeah? You say, why? Because God said so. It's simple. There are some things that get simplified, especially in hermeneutics. When you read the Word of God and that's what God says, you just follow. Now, for example, that the statement about husbands and wives. Wives submit to your husbands. Although now, you know, people have become so smart, they say, no, it's, in the beginning it says submit to one another. Right? It does say submit to one another. But that means you and me. You and me. Now, Sister Glenn, I submit to you, you submit to me. But, you know, there's no teaching about you women submitting to me. Okay, so I can't tell Rosella, hey, Rosella, you have to submit to me. Of course, with Rosella, it might be a problem. You know, if I start teaching that, hey, Rosella, submit to me, right? I can just see yourself going, making up, making pan, going, submit this. Yeah. We'll see who will submit. And that's a misnomer sometimes because there are certain doctrines that teach that women should submit to men in everything. No, you submit being told. Remember this. It's not the husband that submits to the woman. There is no scripture that says husband submit to your woman. Then submit to one another, we submit to one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. But there is no scripture that says husband submit to your woman. Now, people will say, man, you're so chauvinist. Yeah, I am chauvinist, I'm a guy. But that has nothing to do with scripture and its interpretation. Okay? Believe you me, if God told me to submit to my wife because that's the godly thing, I will do it. But that's not what God said. How come some of you are women, but you know, when you were married or when you have husbands, you don't provide for your husbands? Because that's not the biblical science. Husbands are supposed to provide for their wives. Now, how about the people that will babysit their children? Well, they're still providing care. Right? There is still provision there. Right? When you say, oh, the husband stayed at home and the woman worked. It's a different society nowadays. Mm-hmm. You know, but if the husband stayed at home and took care of the children, because the wife is a registered nurse, that's practical. You know, if they really are married, and if the wife is a normal woman, she will understand that this care that is being given to the children is important. But you cannot say to the wife, you do not give your own care. You cannot do that. So, looking at things like that, there are things in scripture, and that's how God says it, so that's how it is. But there are limitations of hermeneutics in the study of the Bible. Sometimes we overinterpret. We come in and we go, here's the effective thing. A lot of people say, I like the illustration of Archangel Michael and Jesus Christ. You know about that all, right? All of you now know about that. How they got to that is because of the fact that they felt that there was this interpretation that was just exclusively for them. It was a new revelation. I say to you, it's a new religion. There is no way, if you're a logical person, that you would have read the scriptures and you would have seen that Archangel Michael is also Jesus Christ. There's no way. Yeah.
On their literature, I mean, do they have like a Bible that says that? I mean, so if you were a kid and you picked that up, it would say it?
I'm going to say this. I was trying to teach in such a way that I became the authority in your life to get my hands on your money or get my hands on your wives, because that would be what my desire would be, or your property. I just changed the literature.
Yeah.
I just changed the literature, and yes, there's always evidence. Oh, this Bible says, yeah. But that's why, hold on, that's why we study the original, understand what the true meaning is. That's why you're blessed, because every one of you who have access to a computer, you type it on your computer and you see the original manuscript. And even if you don't understand that on first look, there are people you can ask. Talk to Pastor Bermudez and let him tell you what that Greek word means or that Hebrew means. Buy a lexicon for Greek, you know? Buy a dictionary for Hebrew. Do your research. There's that original thing. Everybody will have, you know, it's so easy. Right now, all I gotta do is print a certificate of authenticity, then I can sell my iPad and say that this was owned by Steve Jobs. Then I print on the computer a certificate of authenticity. Now it's worth $5,000 instead of the original $599 I bought it for in those years. Yeah. You were saying something?
The Book of Mormon. I think that says a lot about the Mormon, quote-unquote, religion, that they cannot stick to a common Bible, but yet have to have extra book or books to explain how the new revelation from Joe Smith, or what was his name?
Joseph Smith.
Yeah. That tells you right there what to do with
it. The problem there is, for example, myself. You know, I may not like my predecessors. Right? There may have been some people before me in ministry that I did not like. Let's be plain, right? But the one thing I have to says, even though I did not agree with how they lived their lives, one blessing that I have is they were anchored to the word. They cannot go too far. Yeah. So you may not like me. You may not accept me for who I am and my calling. But even then, I am anchored to the word of God. I cannot just decide what to teach you and what the interpretation will be. Okay? Like one major quote in the Philippines, he says, I'm the appointed son of God. You cannot come to the Father except by me. You cannot ignore me. For this day and age, I'm the appointed son of God. As a private plane, vacation from the United States, the whole congregation is dressed in white. The New Jerusalem, he said. So if you're visiting, you look like an outcast. Here's the sheep, there's the goats. This is where they sit, on the orchestra pit. And on the top, you know, if you came, I don't care what you wore. If you wore an Armani suit or shorts, you're on the top, separated. You know, and his members wear white. All white, huh? I'm surprised the Lord did not tell him to put white also in their hair so that they look like angels. You know? But just the slightest twisting, and that becomes what happens to scripture. You cannot, I can guarantee if you want to use scripture for your benefit, you need to make money, which is mostly what the problem is nowadays. You have to put a little truth in. Human nature dictates that they will be attracted to you when you add your deception. That's just what it is. That's why, okay, there's limitations to hermeneutics. There's also sometimes where scripture is just, you know, especially prophecy, you interpret it, but you may be wrong. Always come into that, to God be the glory that we have teachers and we have corroborating evidences. Over thousands of years, these teachings have been perpetuated into the church. But, you know, let's take on one aspect that everyone can be wrong, but, you know, I feel I'm right. I feel that when rapture happens, it will be premillennial. It will be post-tribulation. It will be pre-tribulation, not tribulation time or post-tribulation. Did you understand what I just said? Should I repeat that?
No. Not everyone.
When the tribulation happens, there's the beginning of the tribulation. There's the middle of the tribulation. You know, the hardships, the trials, the demonic force. And then there's after. And I believe that rapture, when we are taken, will happen before the start of the tribulation. Well, my thing is, you know, I'm just thinking, this is off my head. I'm not going to cite scripture, there's scriptures. There's scriptures for every point of debate, those three points. But my thing is, what's the point? Does Jesus love me? So probably he'll take me. Because I'm a father. Okay? If we can escape, I will take my son and escape. I'm a father. Didn't they say we were created by, you know, we were created in the image of God? So there's a certain tendencies, the noble tendencies that are with me, you know, that are here. That's my tendency, the godly tendencies, those things are embedded in me. So if there's conflict, I would like to take my family away from that. Now, we are the bride of Christ. Any of you had a girlfriend? This is what I told my son. My son carrying my wife. He's only about 10 or 12 years old, he carried my wife, and my wife squealed. You know, not that she got hurt. So I looked at him and I said, dude, if that was my girlfriend who did that, I'd slug your face. Okay? Get your own girlfriend. Don't do that. Don't play rough games with my... You're not supposed to do that in front of me. Wasn't that bad, you know, I was a little kid. It's also an object lesson. Understand this, you're a man now. You're not playing games, manly games, with my girlfriend. This is not going to happen. So, saying that, the instincts that are there as a man, we know that God has instincts for his bride. I don't know if God has instincts, that may be a bad teaching. You know? saying, he's consistent. He has protected the church. He has allowed for tribulation, he has to happen for us to grow. But I think at that time, the period for testing and growing is over. Then we are to be held accountable. We are taken to face the Bema Seat, the judgment. Remember? But this is the time now for us to be taken. That's why I believe that it will happen pre-tribulation. Now, I can be wrong. Right? I believe that in my heart. That's the desire. But I can be wrong. That's why it's called prophecy. Because he can do this mid-trib. Just because. What? I'm going to stand there and go, hey, you're late. Are you kidding me? And if you're going to go to heaven and say, you know what? You should have taken me about 20 years earlier. You're going to go there to God. Right in the middle of heaven's gates and say, if you could have come faster. I can guarantee when I get there, I'm just going to go, oh, thank you, Lord. It's by the skin of my teeth, whatever it is. It's, you know, can I come in now? Right? So, can I be wrong? Yes. So there are certain limitations. Because again, obviously, we can interpret the word of God. But all these things, especially prophecy, comes forth under the authority of God. It's a timetable. That's just how it is, right? Describe the characteristics that a good interpreter of scripture should have. What should you have? We studied this last week. Understand what? First? Somebody give me a word. I'm serious. Okay, if you want language, meaning the only language, that's good. Culture, what else?
Time.
Time is what? There's another term. Starts with H. Mr. History, right? Or the historicity, or the historicalness, right? Alright? For example, again, we talked about this before. The man that will go through the eye of the needle. That doesn't mean here's the needle, that man will go there, that's a gate. We now know what that is, right? When we talk about the skull, what are we talking about? The skull. S-K-U-L-L. The hill of the skull, what are we talking about? Hill of the skull? We're talking about Golgotha, okay?
Okay.
That's the context of Calvary, right? So, we need to understand that the scripture, especially the New Testament, was during the Roman times. You need to understand the difference between the context of scripture as it was being delivered during the time of David. David's time was conflict and unification. Solomon was during the time of power, and you know they were the ones that were the strongest. You know? And then during the time of the New Testament, they were under the control of the Roman Empire. So there are these things that we need to understand. You cannot read the Bible and think that this is what you believe, and so it will be. For example, I have people, this is what fascinates me. I have people that say, it's okay for people to have abortions or women's rights. They call it women's rights. The legalized abortion thing is still an okay deal. How can that be when you read scripture? I don't fault those people who don't go to church, but if you go to church, oh man. How you vote, how you conduct your life, I don't see it. Okay? And they have certain biases, so they find scripture. I have a friend. Yeah.
The colleges right now, that's what they teach. That's why my son Christian, you know, his beliefs are not.
That's always been the case though. Remember this, especially nowadays. High school is hell. Alright? You don't know what your children are going through. I sort of do because you know what? I'm not better than you, but God bless me. Before, I was unemployed or underemployed. So I spent time with my son in elementary school. That's when I learned how he learned to curse and this and that. And I felt sorry because when we started in preschool, he was in Christian schools. But as soon as he went to magnet school, he started to learn how to curse and learn all these things. You know. And bad stuff. He's already exposed to it. Right now, he's, right now, basically, I'm pretty sure he's exposed to the worst stuff, whatever. I look like a virgin in my high school days compared to him. And then when you go to college, okay, if you're naive, I'm sorry, but even during my time when I was young and still skinny, I used to hang out at places like UCLA and Pepperdine. In my opinion, that's where the most attractive women were. I was single. Okay? I was married in 96, so this was 86 onwards. I spent time in UCLA, I spent time in Pepperdine, and man, the hot. You know? And I would not say that I was an angel, but when I got there, it was amazing. Out of boredom, you know? If you don't, gosh, can I be graphic? No, never mind, I'm on tape. But, you know, it's amazing. It's just amazing. Well, things that you would never think was going to happen, this happens. And I was told it was even calmer because the sexual revolution had already passed. Imagine in the 70s it was even worse. And I'm thinking, whoa, this is the, you know? So, our children go through that on a regular basis. I talked to these kids that are with us from Las Vegas, they said, people there carry knives, they fight. They feel safer here in California in the schools. And I thought they were better. Now, describe the person that a good interpreter of scripture should have. You should understand history, context. You should understand what else? Well, you know, if you read your Bible, that's a good help, right? Though we hardly talk about that. If you read your Bible, you know your Bible interprets itself. Mm-hmm. If you don't understand, if you read your Bible, you will get a better grasp and a better understanding of it. Okay? A lot of times, scripture will explain scripture. Some of you who are fond of going to school and listening to teachers, stop that. I know it sounds weird, right? But really, scripture teaches you. That's why in these classes, I endeavor not to teach, but to sort of move your head this way and that. That's why, remember, sometimes I'd be deliberately vague. In order that you would be forced to read scripture, consider other options. Remember our first night when we were talking about praying for the dead? But you never considered that option. You just accepted it. Why? Because somebody taught you. Okay, so now when you're challenged, you go, you know, and that's what happens outside. Beliefs are challenged, convictions are challenged. These things are offered to our children. That's why those of you who are here, I'm going to ask you this, right? You will have children in the church. I'm one of them. Even if you don't have children, please, for us to be successful, those children have to be trained. The first thing they need to learn is when they come to church, they sit down. They don't go out and do their work. You know? I've noticed for some reason our children are in and out, in and out, in and out. Somebody has to be the bad guy. And I don't have the time. That used to be my job. Yeah. That was my job, man. I wasn't afraid. Like I said, some of the children thought I was when they went to sleep, they had their dreams, they thought I was Dracula. And I didn't mind. My wife said, you look like an animal. I am an animal. Heck, you're gonna mess with the service? I am an animal. This is the animal, you hear me? Yeah, I wouldn't back down from anybody. I didn't care if they were taller than me. I didn't care if their dad, because we used to even have homeless people here. I didn't care if their dads wanted to pick a fight. Come on now. You will not mess with the church like that. And you know what? They're walking in and out. You know what? Here's the problem. In their homes, they have computers. They have iPods, they have TV, they have cable, so they're used to having their minds subjugated. When I was young, I was bored. I thank God I was bored. You know what I did when I was bored? What do you do when you're bored? You slept? No, me. I thought about lyrics, and then I started writing in my head. I'd be bored, so sometimes they don't take a side. They don't let me be a bullshit. That's the cat.
You wrote that?
No.
That's not just.
That's America. But then I would write
that's
my own
America.
Thing. For example, right now I can write my own thing. I just go in my head. You know? Some are quick to take the bait and catch a camel. There's no other price right on the shelf. And all that's a piece of literature with the thin man. You go, and then I would flip the thin man and go. If I don't get up. And then I would pick songs in my head. It's just, you know, then I would do lyrics, I would rap. Yeah. I know some people never heard me rap, but you know, as soon as I heard, do the hip, hop, after school, I take a dip in the pool with this lady, bought two clothes. I have a color TV so I can see who could be playing basketball. Everybody knows. You know? But I was bored. Now, to everyone else, maybe to you, it's a waste of time. But you know what? Once I start putting it down on paper, my teacher started to freak.
But now kids are like good. They're multitasker right now. Kids, they can do.
Yeah, but they need to be led by the nose.
All kinds of.
And you know what? If you have kids, you should let them be bored. That's good for them. Seriously. If you have ADD children, that's what they should do is be bored. Let them bang their heads for a little while. And it's a help for them. Okay, this is the describe basic disorders necessary for credible interpretation of the Bible. What do you mean?
The Bible.
Okay, good. And you know what, you guys who are students, try to find a good study Bible for yourselves. Okay? They're not that expensive. Here's how you get them. You go to the thrift store and you wait for one. Doesn't matter what translation, even it's New King James, you buy it for $2.95. Don't pay money for books. Okay? Don't pay money for books. If you have money, pay money. You have money. For me, I just go to a thrift store and I just keep walking in and out. Don't go shopping for clothes. No. Don't go shopping for a meal. Just walk in there, you look at the books, oh, there's a Bible. And sometimes, you know, we get that for $2.95. I haven't done it in a while because I have no more space. We ran out of space. Okay, what else do you need? Get a good Bible dictionary if you can find one. Try not to buy anything new. You know, it's just my advice. Here's free financial advice. If you're going to buy a car, don't buy a brand new car. Buy a 2-year-old car. That just makes perfect sense. You don't do the depreciation, you get it, and your insurance is less, your registration is less. You know, get something that's low mileage and used. Yeah. Me, I buy everything used except for something right under. I can't handle that. Walmart. Before. You know what I'm talking about. There ain't no way. It's just my imagination once a year. If I buy my underwear from somewhere. Now it was just my imagination. Alright, so you need a dictionary, okay, you need a concordance, and these concordances, even in the bookstores, when the concordances get old, they are on sale. And you're thinking, oh, please don't buy the strongest of the strongest of the strong. You ain't even that strong yet. You know what I mean? People go like, well, the latest version is the strongest of the strongest of the strongest of the strong. Comprehensive. Because they call it the Strong's Concordance. That's the big thing. Buy the one that's old. The one from the 1980s. You know, you haven't even read your Bible. You want to read the concordance. You want the best concordance. Not helping you. Right? And then learn the languages. Learn Hebrew and learn Greek. Not from the highfalutin words, not from the textbooks, not even from the institute. Go and use your computer. For example, those of you that were here last Sunday evening, when you heard Pastor preach, remember he termed that mist? Because you asked a mist, what's the Greek word? Do you remember? Did you look it up? You guys just heard it and said, yeah, huh? Okay? You should have looked at that word, amigo. It looks like in the wall.
No, sin.
Amiss. You know, type that word. You know, you have your syllabus from last week, or from the Sunday. The one that says you ask amiss, you don't receive because you have asked amiss. Okay? Go look that up, type that up, look for it in Greek, and you will see what I'm talking about. Isn't that such a big teaching? Your privilege to understand that it's not just asking wrong, but that you have asked and missed the mark. Not Mark Mullen. See? And then finally, this develop a desire to understand the accurate and dark message of any particular text of Scripture. When we say that, that means read more. If you need to analyze one verse, read 5 verses before and 5 verses after. Don't be an expert on one. Because I know sometimes you hear us and we preach up on one verse and you go, oh, that's how it should be. No. The study is always more in-depth. When I was younger, before I became a pastor, I had 2 Bibles. I had an open Bible and an NIV study Bible. And a pastor saw it and said, why are you studying that way? You have 2 Bibles. I said, I want to become a pastor. The first thing he told me was, you really want that life? It's not a good life. And I told him, yeah, all my friends who are pastors have told me that, but I'm going to be a pastor. I'm going to live a good life. And he laughed. Some pastors who are mobile, they will tell you the truth right off the bat to find out if you will be distracted and you're not going to be. Being a pastor is hard. One of the hardships is this, as we close, so I can encourage you, because if you are sleeping, you get more coffee. When you pastor, the standards are higher. Once you start trying to learn about music, the standards are higher. The people watch your behavior. Your witnessing starts with how you carry yourself. And the problem with us is sometimes we make decisions based on need. Do not make decisions based on your need. God will meet your needs. But when we make decisions based on our needs, that ruins us. That's why I live a simple life. Do you know this? I don't want to compete. I don't want a new car. You know? To me, a fully loaded car means you have side airbags. Trust me. Used car with side airbags, that's fully loaded. I don't need a good looking car. I don't want to pay more insurance. I don't want to pay more registration. I don't want new clothes. I told my wife, I said, please don't buy me any clothes. You know? I just realized now that it becomes cooler. I look at how many jogging pants, okay? How many sets of jogging pants I have. And I said, man, I can go a month and not repeat one jogging pants. And I'm looking at my labels, Adidas, Aeropostale, you know? I'm looking, ooh. I don't even use these things.